Good afternoon. Good evening. Good morning. Okay. Yeah, it's one of those nights. Another one of those nights. Oh. Sorry, I get my headset hooked up here. So I'll explain my location here in a minute. My battery periodically, and I have not figured out what makes it do it, but it goes dead. That's been going back. But up there is the yard light, and it is a 72 LED yard light. So with that as a background, well, I guess I should hold it like that. You know, it's looking about like daylight there. You know. Okay, I'm looking right at it now. Of course, the sun hasn't quite got down, so the blue is still sky behind me. Anyway, real pretty. Right out in front of the yard is a big, another big oak tree. Not quite as big as that. Not nearly as big as that one in back. The one by the barn, I kid you not, is 8 feet at the base. So, but anyway, so what I'm doing is instead of getting a jump box and getting this and getting that, I got a little charger, and I finally was like, I got a big one, a real shop charger, a Schumacher. And right now I was trying to spend a few hours today trying to find the manual for it online so I could figure out how to use it, which was an interesting exercise, because one guy said, man, I've been a mechanic for 40 years and I just want a charger that works when you push a button. Not something that's smarter than you are, that thinks it's smarter than you are. Well, this is a good charger because it's got auto start and it's an automatic charger, and it's smart enough not to blow your battery up, not to overcharge it. So for most people, it's probably a really good one. And once I just sat down in front of it, like at night, it's not a time to try to figure it out. You know, sitting down in front of it and looking at the buttons and pushing them, they all have like a push auto start and it auto starts. That's what it's there for. It's a big red button. All the other buttons are smaller. So you hit the red button, auto start, guess what? It charges your battery. It's smarter than you are. It won't blow the battery up. So, got a call from Jared. Shout out to him. He probably won't see this for a long time, but he just got in from Wyoming with his daughter, a four-year-old daughter, and she's having a blast. And they're out there on their 1 acre. So, again, once we get something going, I mean, he may... You know, it's going to be a challenge, maybe an exciting challenge. He does have a good tent. He's from Wyoming. Sure, he knows what cold weather is, so he'll probably be fine. I'm going to get in touch with him about a couple things. Like, you know, he did lawns up there, so if he wanted to come by here for a free dinner and have a good time here and swimming pool and play around, go to Bass Pro and whatnot and mow our lawn in a few weeks, that would be cool. Nice trade-off. But anyway, Homestead Crossing, got it from Homestead Crossing. So anyway, sooner or later we have got to come up with a way to develop, have land for people so they don't have to go that route, because a lot of people are going to be coming up from the cities trying to do it, and it's going to be very difficult. All right, so I'm going to read 4 minutes. I'll probably cut this one in two parts. It's already two parts. I mean, maybe three parts. All right. So we interrupt this program. Christmas. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. You know, for a guy the John Horn guy doesn't like Christmas, but doesn't say why. It's not like it's an antithetical, you know, anti-Christian thing. It's just like he don't like Christmas. Well, there's a lot of reasons not to like Christmas. You know, you don't have to be all pro-Christmas, pro-Santa, pro-gift-giving, you know. You can be honest and saying, hey, it's a pagan holiday. You know, most of us that are listening, I mean, I'm sure that about everybody that listens to me right now is not observing Christmas. Maybe some people probably are. But, you know, by and large, you figure out, hey, this is commercialized, it's not good, it's tied up with Babylon, and I'm getting out of it. So, like I said, we were starting to get away from the whole, like, if I'm gonna get a Christmas present, it's gonna have to be good. So I would actually start taking stuff back, you know, and I'd get something real, camping, hunting stuff, something, you know, don't give me a toy or a trinket, give me a gun or a knife, you know, or a compass or binoculars or something that's worthwhile, sleeping bag. Anyway, but the other part of it is, it's, you know, it's a satanic holiday, basically. All right, so shut up, Jerry. Sorry. Updates and rants and rambles and speaking from the heart and whatever. All right. Christmas part one. Cool, said Melinda and Brittany as they examined the pigs in their stall in the barn. They're all for us? For us? Heather said dubiously as she eyed the squealing hogs pushing against each other to get their share of the feed that John had just put down. John grinned and said, well, actually, just the two females. The other two are castrated males, and they're for the family. As soon as the sows come into heat, Eddie will bring over one of his boars to breed them. When they litter, you'll be in business. We're going to be pig farmers? Heather asked incredulously. Oh, Heather, Melinda said, exasperated. Pigs are so cool. You should see the little piglets when they're young. They're so cute. You'll like them, and we get to keep the money. Butcher pigs sell for a lot, don't they, Daddy? Well, we can hope, darling, her father replied. You three will get to keep the profits once the expenses have been deducted. How well you manage them will determine how much profit y'all make. But they stink worse than the goats do, Heather lamented. Her mother and father laughed, and Lisa said, that's the smell of money, dear. Just keep reminding yourself that's the smell of money. You're lucky Uncle John is letting you keep the profits. When I was your age, I had to feed the stock for just my normal allowance. Not that it amounted to much. I can tell you that. Your grandfather was a big believer on keeping children short on pocket money, but long on hugs and kisses. Hey, you know what? I don't have to be charging this thing. I don't know. I'm just sitting out here. Sorry about that. If they're picked up much noise, but I don't need to have it on. I'll flick it on when I'm done. When do we get the goslings, Daddy? Melinda asked excitedly. Well, that rather depends on the geese, sugar, her father explained. Eddie, that's Mr. Morgenstern to you three, says we can expect them in late March or early April. They're Chinese weeder geese, supposed to be very efficient at getting most of their feed from range with only a little grain on the side. I'm not sure that they'll butcher out to, but he says they lay well. How come you changed your mind, Daddy? I thought you said we were never going to have geese. John's face clouded up at the question, and he hesitated a moment before answering. Well, Mel, I reckon you can thank your mother for that. She insisted that y'all have a backup plan in addition to the pigs, and since we're already doing chickens, and I won't have a guinea on the place, she and Lisa decided geese were the answer. I was outvoted. All I can say is that Mr. Gander had better be a perfect gentleman if you want to stay in the goose breeding business. Do you understand? Melinda cut her eyes at Brittany and Heather, then said, yes, sir, I understand. Her father looked down into his coffee mug and observed, I think I'm about due for a refill. How about you guys? We ought to be checking on that ham and getting the turkey ready to go in the oven, Lisa, Ann said. At least this year it's cold enough that cooking a meal will feel good. Going to be quite a crowd for Christmas dinner this year. It certainly will be by the time Judy and her kids show up, the Stricklands and Mike's family. We're going to be bursting at the seams, Lisa smiled. I have to admit, I'm kind of excited. I've always loved big Christmases like we used to have when I was a girl. The house full of people, a smell of wood smoke in the air, snow on the ground. It'll be just like back home in Ohio. John grunted. I wish all of this snow was in Ohio, but it'll be good regardless. The parents left the barn for the house, leaving the three girls to observe their new charges. After the door shut, Brittany asked Melinda, are these geese something we shouldn't ask Uncle John about? He seems a little touchy about them. Melinda giggled, then said, well, you probably shouldn't. Daddy is embarrassed about it and never discusses them. But if you'll both promise never to say anything in front of him, I'll tell you why. The girls refused to say anything further until both the other girls had solemnly promised never to say a word to anyone. While she explained, it's like this. Daddy has this friend by the name of Pete Finnegan who lives up in High Springs. They're always trying to talk each other into buying, trying new things. And once, about 5 years ago, Mr. Pete up and got geese. I can't recall what breed they were now, but they were really big and snow white. They were really beautiful, and they'd eat corn out of my hand. Then when they were about a year old, the gander, that's the male goose, started feeling his oats and getting really mean. He never bothered me or Mama, but every time we went up there, he tried to attack Daddy. Well, Mr. Pete kept telling Daddy that if he'd just be friendlier with him, he wouldn't attack him so much. He said the gander never attacked him because he fed him every day. So one time when we were there, he gave Daddy a bucket of corn and told him to let the gander eat some out of his hand. Daddy threw some on the ground, then bent over and stuck his hand out full of corn at the gander. Well, the gander acted like he was going to take some of the corn out of his hand, then reached up and bit Daddy's nose. The girl started laughing so hard she couldn't go on. After a moment, she collected herself enough to finish her story. You should have seen that. Daddy was using Yangle language that Mama always scolds him for using and chasing the gander all over the yard with his axe in his hand. Mr. Pete was chasing after Daddy, yelling to him not to hurt his bird. Mama and Miss Jeannie, Mr. Pete's wife, were chasing after Mr. Pete, yelling at him not to chase an angry man with an axe in his hand. Everyone but Daddy was laughing so hard that we could hardly stand up. Daddy never did hit the bird, said his eyes were watering too bad to see clearly. Later, Miss Jeannie told Mama that the gander attacked Mr. Pete all the time, and they were planning on eating him for Christmas. Mr. Pete had told Daddy the story as a joke. I'm not sure if Mama ever told him the truth or not. You should have seen Daddy's nose. It was all black and blue and looked like he'd been in a fist fight or something. After that, Daddy always swore he'd never have geese as long as he lived. I was really surprised when he said he was going to give us goslings.